Hello, happy site owners, and welcome to the Blog Aid Blab channel. You're watching the WP Blab, and I'm your host, Mayanna. And today, my special guest is John Overall of the WP Plugins A to Z podcast. Hey, John, how you doing?
Doing fantastic.
I want everybody to know who John is because he's been doing this forever. And if you don't know John, you need to get to know John. He's a WordPress trainer and speaker and specializes these days in site hack repairs, but he's a co-host of the long-running WP Plugins A to Z podcast and shares his test results and insights about free and paid plugins. And John, you've been doing this a long time now, haven't you?
I discovered WordPress about 2008, just after I sold my computer store, and I've been working with it ever since.
Well, and listen, with this plugins thing, I want to preface this for everybody so that they know really how deep your knowledge is. You've been doing hack specialty stuff. I mean, you know WordPress deep. You've been in it as a developer. So when you're looking at plugins, you're looking at it with not just an eye for functionality, but all the way through with not just fashion. But you're looking at the functionality, you're looking at the core, you're looking at performance, security, you're looking at a lot of things, right?
Usually, yes. Yeah. Digging in to make sure it functions and performs as it should, keep websites from, having problems.
Okay. So guys, that's the main thing I want you to know, because you know what a stickler I am about function and performance and security. And I want you to know that John is even deeper in it than I am. As far as looking at, digging into WordPress these days, because I don't do that anymore. I gave that up because it is a specialty thing these days. So, and before we get too far gone I want to tell people about your important Kickstarter campaign too, so they find this right at the top of the show so that they can get involved with it too. Tell us about that.
The Kickstarter program is to allow me to take my podcast and the website associated with it to a full-time business. And I originally started the podcast as a way to help improve my business, which it has done quite nicely. But what happened is it eventually became a complete part-time gig. And over the last several months, it became almost a headache at times. But I have a fan base out there that really enjoys the show, and I truly enjoy doing it because it's lots of fun. The problem is I have to make a choice between my development business or my podcast. And I can't just drop my development business and take up the podcast because I've never monetized it. And the Kickstarter is to allow me to raise the money necessary to put my development business aside for a minimum of 6 months to be able to make sure the podcast is going to become successful. So that's what I started it out to do that. And then hopefully the community is going to support me through that and get me to the goal I need.
I hope so too, because we're going to talk about this with plugins in general and free plugins and whatever, but I think this is where we're moving. And I think you would agree with me that the days of everything being free, that whole free model, I know other folks have talked about this years and years and years ago. This is unsustainable.
It is unsustainable. I know when I first started my show, I started talking about the rise of the freemium model or the premium plugins. But at that time there, probably 95% or more of the plugins were free in the repository. But over the last couple of years, I've seen plugins develop the same way themes developed in the beginning. Themes rapidly became a premium process, but plugins were slower to adopt that. But in the last couple of years, you see tons of it now. If you download a plugin from the repository, probably 7 out of 10 times now when I download one, it's a freemium version of the plugin. It's not fully free. They give you just enough functionality to determine whether it's going to provide the necessities you need. And then they charge you for the rest of it, which is how the model has evolved, of course, mainly because software, you need to be able to test it to find out if it's going to work. And if you go out and spend $30 for something, find out it doesn't work, 9 out of 10 developing companies say, nope, sorry, you bought it, you own it. We can't give you a refund. It's a digital product, which I understand.
Yeah.
But by them giving away the freemium version, hey, it gives everyone a happy chance to test it out.
Yeah, I think so too, because a lot of plugin developers have just been burned out on the support because, even for me and everybody else that deals with WordPress, things are changing so much faster when they went to this model of updating so much more regularly, you know, 3 or 4 times a year now.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Security has become such a huge issue. I mean, it's turned into a circus with some of it. And for site owners, it's just becoming nuts. But this whole idea that everything we need to make money should be free, that mindset's got to go, doesn't it?
It is. And then it's slowly eking its way out as people realize that there is no such thing as a free lunch. Somebody has to pay for that work somewhere along the line. Many of my clients discovered it as they started with a free plugin that was developed by some kid in college who was doing it as a hobby. They came to depend on that plugin. A kid graduated college, got himself a job at some corporation, while his pet project went the way of the dodo. And these people were left stuck suddenly with a plugin that they depended on that they couldn't get any support for anymore. Mm-hmm. And now they had to hire someone to go in and rewrite the plugin or bring it up to date for them. And that's what's happening more and more. And of course, plugin authors are realizing, hey, I write a good enough plugin, I can make it into a recurring income by providing the updates and the support for it, by charging them an annual fee to do that. Mm-hmm. So, and that is the big benefits of it.
Right. You get somebody who's going to be there for you and, you know, who has the interest, continuing interest, because it's monetized, it's worth their time to keep up with all this stuff, because I don't think people really understand how much work it is to keep up. And that's part of your Kickstarter program, and why you're having to do this is because of all the hours and all this work that you've done that serves our community so well. And asking the community to support you, I think, is very fair.
Well, I like to remind people, like, I have clients from time to time ask me about doing podcasts, and I say, okay, how long do you want your show to be? And they say, well, 20 minutes. I say, great. You ready to commit 4 to 6 hours a week to your show? Mm-hmm. Because that's what it takes.
Uh-huh.
For every half hour of show, you're 3 to 5 hours worth of work in research, notes, typing, recording. If you happen to edit it, I don't really edit mine, but I still do a lot of research and notes and everything that goes into it. And that's the reason. The other thing is the website can be so much more than it is. I offer up, I've done training videos, and I intend to do more of those. I intend to expand the show to include interviews with authors, developers. In fact, my first author interview is going out tomorrow. I did one yesterday with a plugin developer. It was a great one. It's really a great plugin too. They'll be coming out in tomorrow's show with the review of the plugin.
Well, I am thrilled to hear that, because, you know, I work with a lot of developers. I hang out with a lot of developers, and most end users never get to talk to these people. And come on, let's face it, a lot of developers just rather sit in a corner and code than be on something like this, you know, especially on camera or whatever. So maybe a podcast where they can just talk on the phone with you, or, you know, voice over IP or whatever suits them, if you do a word in video. But I'm really glad to hear that you're going to be letting us hear more right out of the horse's mouth from these folks about what being a developer now is really like. It's not easy at all.
Oh, but also the other thing about it is to bring the developer's viewpoint in about his plugin, why he developed it, how he feels it can be best used in the WordPress environment. You know, mm-hmm. They can talk about more than their usual promotional materials. And the developers are really great. Like the ones I did yesterday from a plugin called Push Crew, those developers were over in India. So it's like the wonderful thing about Skype is being able to have a good connections nowadays where you can talk to somebody half a globe away.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's really, really kind of cool and exciting. And the developers are all over the world.
Yes, they are. Some of my favorite ones are in Israel, Australia. I mean, they're all over Greece. They're all over the world. So it's really wonderful. And I enjoy the communities and being able to talk. Language can be a barrier sometimes with that. You know, the forums are good because they can translate and whatever. Let's move on to some of the issues that I know, you know, people want to know about with plugins, because they've been hearing me harp on all the changes that are coming. We're going to get to those really big changes first. But I want to ask you, because I have you here and you've been covering this so long, I want to hear your unique perspective on the trend that you're seeing. We've already talked about going to paid versions, you know, having the freemium. Mm-hmm. But what about complexity, security, apps that are coming out, you know, with all the changes that are coming with WordPress, you know, everything almost being a cloud service, you know, service as sales kind of thing. Could you tell us more about all of that?
The complexity of them, I'm seeing the complexity is more along the line of the themes. The plugins I'm seeing now more, the developers are starting to realize they need to make them as less complex, have a plugin for a very specific purpose and have it just that purpose and add just the functionality that is needed for that plugin to function. This way they get a plugin that requires minimal amount of support. They don't have to answer a ton of questions and they can make the interface very usable and they can also make it so it performs very well on WordPress. Themes, on the other hand, they're throwing tons of stuff into them to make them complex. The service as a software platform, the SaaS, that's I'm seeing more and more. It's like, again, the one where I talked to the author yesterday from Push Crew, this one here is a plugin that you put in your WordPress site that allows you to send out notifications to web device or to mobile devices and desktop computers. So you can send push notifications from your WordPress website. This is actually a really cool service in that it allows you to be able to send notifications to your users, whether they're on your website or not. They'll get that notification provided they subscribe to you. Mm-hmm. These sorts of services more and more are coming on. I've got another one coming up, which is a plugin that will import blabs and put them on your website as a post and include those comments in the sidebar. So
yeah,
there's some
I've
really
covered
great
that
ones.
One. Yeah, yeah, well, I've covered the Simple Live Press one.
That's the one I'm talking about. I just discovered
Honey,
it. I just discovered it.
Yeah, and actually, I'm kind of hanging out with him because I know he's got all he can stand on his plate for a multi-user version of it, so that you can bring in more than one blab show, because I think that's going to explode some sites when that happens. I've got some things working in the wings just waiting on him, but I know he's got all he can stand to keep up because blab changes every 5 minutes, too, sometimes, and he has to keep up, but... Yeah, I think opportunities, you know, with new things coming up, opportunities like that are always opening up for smart devs who are keeping up with the marketplace as well.
And that's it. There's always something new in developers, and there's also old problems that still need to be solved. And occasionally, if you can't do it, you can always hire a developer to do it. There's always someone out there who can write the code for your idea.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's what's happening more and more. And WordPress is, it's not going away. I mean, it currently runs, approximately 25% of the internet and growing.
And if Matt Mullenweg has his druthers about it, it'll be double that.
Yeah, well, it might eventually reach 30 to 40%, and that'll probably be its peak. But that's still a vast number of websites to deal with and provide a service for. And plugins has always been the way to answer the problems, because if you want that problem solved, you plug something in. If you no longer have that problem, you turn it off and it doesn't impact any of the other functionality of your site. That's mm-hmm. the beauty of the plugin.
Well, let's talk about good, bad, and ugly here. How do you determine, because you've tested them all. Let's tell me, how many do you have on your test site right this second?
Last time I looked at 256.
See, okay. Yeah. So this is the guy you go to if you want to find out if you have a conflict.
Yeah.
There's
also a website to help you with that too. But yeah, how I determine plugins that are good and bad, basically what I do is I install it on my dev site and I start turning on, sort of plugins that go with it to see if there's conflicts. And see what happens with it. I look for how it slows down the speed. I have a plugin that I use that monitors the memory usage and the CPU usage of the server. And I can't remember the plugin's name off the top of my head, but it just puts right up in your admin bar. It tells you how much memory you're using, how much CPU is being used.
Mm-hmm.
And when you turn on a plugin, you can see the memory increase and decrease accordingly. So you can determine all of that. I mean, my own personal website runs probably about 56 plugins using about 65 megs of RAM. You know, mm-hmm. it impacts CPU performance probably a few cycles, not majorly. But the biggest thing you're looking at is, does it slow down your site by putting in that plugin? Do the plugins you're running together slow down your site or impact performance? And you can't just judge it from the back end. You have to go look at your front end. And that's where it's more important, because your visitors are going to be at the front end. They're never going to be in your back end. Because your back end, sometimes plugins, when they turn on, they do nothing in the back end, but they impact the front end majorly.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to look at how the code is loaded into it, whether it's loaded properly in queued scripts, all of that information has to be noted. Mm-hmm. It goes on the list. Basically, for the most part, I turn them on, test them, see how they function. I read through their description. I see if it does what their description says it's going to do for me. And then I see if it's going to impact the website. And if it doesn't, it gets a decent rating. I mean, we have a wonderful dragon scale rating on WP plugins. It goes up to 5 dragons. Getting a 5 dragon is a rarity for a plugin with us. I mean, you can listen back to our podcast shows for eons and you'll hear occasionally we'll hit a streak of 5s, but most of them land between 3 and 4, and occasionally there's 1 and 2s. And well, we're not afraid to call them out when they happen.
Right, and that environment's very different now because there were 9,000 plugins added just this year alone, and I think you told me earlier in another blab, there were only 9,000 plugins at all when you started, right?
Yeah, when I started the show, there was 9,000 plugins.
Yeah, 40,000 free ones, and then all of the paid and all the freemium and all that kind of stuff now. So what are we looking at, 60, 70,000 plugins?
Who knows where it's going to stop. As long as WordPress keeps going, people will keep creating plugins. One of the interesting things I note is when searching for plugins or when testing plugins is how many different plugins there are to solve the same problem. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not uncommon if you got a problem you want to solve it. Oh, we'll take the simplest one, YouTube video. You want to put a YouTube video up on your website? Go look up YouTube plugins. There's probably several hundred of them by now.
Right.
But you have to figure out which one's going to provide what you want it to do. And that's the other thing I look at when I'm examining a plugin. Is it easy for the user to use? I look at it from the user's perspective, not from mine. Being technical, I can work my way through them rather quickly. But can the user work his way through it? That's the important thing. Is it easy to set up? Is it good functionality? Has it got good connection? Is it a freemium plugin? You know, because freemium plugins do sort of impact the rating. The other thing that impacts it is, does the developer author hide the fact that it's freemium when they're put it in a repository? It's not uncommon. It's happened to me a few times. I install a plugin, it looks free. I go to use it. Next thing I know, 90% of it is crippled, and they don't tell you it's premium until you actually start to do something.
Wow.
I've been going on about that one for a while. Authors, I have no problem with a freemium plugin. Charge premium
just
price.
Tell us what's going to work and what doesn't.
That's exactly it. I've had some that have hidden it so completely, I didn't know it was a freemium plugin. So I clicked on it, and all of a sudden, I'm on their website. It's like, what's this? So
yeah,
those ones there.
Repository, I think that's a real gray thing to do, too. You need to really be upfront about it. You know, just to get a listing on there, it has to be free.
It's a major gray zone with the repository. They do have rules around it, but those rules are written in such a way that lots of authors push so far up against them and push right over the edge. But it's still, the plugins are, for the most part, done fantastically, you know, especially now. It's not like looking at plugins, say, 5 years ago. They were some pretty horrid ones 5 years ago or even
No kidding. There was some real junk. I mean, real. Not that there still isn't. But, you know, there was some real junk out there. Now, I want to talk about a couple of my pet peeves, because when I do site audits, what I find is a lot of people have tried plugins, deleted them, tried another one, deleted it, and it leaves all this orphan code of, you know, a folder in their plugins folder. It'll leave a folder for itself, maybe files scattered around in different places. Code that it inserted into things like the HT access, database tables, and it orphaned all this stuff. You know, every plugin developer, most, I would say, the majority of them don't clean up after themselves if you delete either, do they?
No, unfortunately, the ability of the plugin authors to clean up on themselves has only slightly gotten better in the last few years. More and more of them are putting in a proper uninstall where it cleans up any files. And the worst one is database tables.
Yes.
And that's a big one that a lot of people don't realize is they'll install plugins. It'll add new database tables, but that plugin won't remove those tables when it leaves. And
WordPress,
those tables.
One of the worst of the 20 database tables, guys. Yeah. 20 database tables. And there are others that are just
There are lots of others. There's ones that I've used in the past, and I only discovered recently going through some of my old database tables. Like, oh, I removed that plugin ages ago. What's that table still doing there? Because I don't remember to go look in my database to see orphan tables. But there are plugins to help you clean up those orphan tables.
Mm-hmm.
There's a really great one. again, names are going to jump out of my head. And
well, you only got 10,000 in your head.
I know.
Come on, John.
That's why we have links. I can look them up when I go to a website and find them within minutes, but I'm not going to impact the show here. But anyway, it goes through and it'll tell you what tables are not being used. But even those plugins that help you clean up, you have to be careful because it might find a table that technically is being used, and if you delete it, you can break your website. So you have to be aware of how you use these tools to clean up the mess.
Yeah, that's why I do them manually for my clients, because I can double check what they, I don't trust a plugin to do much other than clean up, you know, like WP-Optimize. And those dashes, that makes a big difference. If you spell it differently, you'll come up with a whole other plugin. It's crazy. Mm-hmm. But WP-Optimize is the one. Now, there was another one, WP Cleaner, that I really like too, but it's
WP Spring Clean.
Yeah, it just hasn't been updated, but it cleans out mainly the comment metadata, the post metadata, and that's what really builds up on you. So let's talk about good ways to find all these plugins, because like you said, when you go into the repository, you can find 100, and there's no way to sort through that kind of stuff. I know people follow me for what I recommend, but I'm not checking every possible use for every kind of scenario or keeping up with them. You are.
Yeah. Well, when I go looking for a plugin, I'll start with the broadest keyword. Like if I'm going for YouTube, I'll go type in YouTube plugins, and then I'll scan through and look at what comes up. And I'll pick a few more refined keywords, and I'll keep refining the keywords down until I get what I want. I mean, WordPress search, everyone knows, is got a little to be desired.
A little.
And even their repository search is not there. Like even one minor typo will return you nothing. They don't return on typos. So you have to watch what you're typing and everything else. But it's just a matter of what I do, and this is how I'm looking for a plugin when I'm looking in the repository. I'll type in the words I'm looking for, and I'll get the list of plugins. Then I'll scan their descriptions and see what their descriptions say. One thing I ignore 100% of the time is the star rating. Just so everyone knows, the star ratings mean absolutely squat to me, because those star ratings have been manipulated for so long, they became completely untrustworthy to me. Eventually that may change, but right now, no. Once I find a plugin that looks interesting, I'll go click on the description for it and pop up the window, and I'll jump over to their screenshots. If a plugin author is not taking the time to put screenshots in, I will abandon it immediately. Because what I need is I need an instant scan to see what it's going to look like from the developer's point of view and maybe from the front end point of view.
And the front end, that's the one thing, like calendar plugins, anything that's going to have a widget that appears on your site and they leave out screenshots of how it's going to appear. Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's another one of my pet peeves. It's like, God, that's why people install and delete and install and delete so much, because they can't even see what it's going to look like.
They have no idea what it's going to look like. And those two things there, once I've got those, if it looks like it's valuable, then I'll install it. And then I will go through the setup and everything else and spend some time on it, and then I'll check out the front end of it. So in all of that, that's, you know, you can spend, well, easily, I've spent easily hours searching for one single plugin. You know, once I've exhausted the repository, if I can't find what I don't want there, then I'll start in on Envato and go over to Code Canyon and see what Code Canyon has, because they've become a very nice repository now.
Right.
And other than that, be wary if you search on Google for plugins, because on websites that can create you problems.
Yeah, themes and plugins both. You know, it could have malware, it could have major security issues.
Never download a premium plugin from the free premium plugin websites that are out there.
Right.
Those are very dangerous to your website's health, probably 8 out of 10 times, because they go in and edit the code and make their own custom changes, and what those changes are could be anything. Plus, you won't get the support for keeping it up to date. So one of the big things I warn people against.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Keeping up to date. We're going to talk more about that. I want to take a station ID break, because we've had a lot of people come in. If you just come in, you're watching the Blog A Blab channel. This is the WP Blab. We're here every Wednesday. I'm your host, Mayanna. My special guest is John Overall, who runs the podcast WP Plugins A to Z. And listen, he's been doing this forever, just ever, like since WordPress. Okay,
yeah, so he knows his make stuff. Me feel old here, Mayanna.
Well, no, it's not that. I'm just as old as you are then, you know, for sure. Now, I want to remind people of your Kickstarter campaign because you want to do more of this. You want to be able to devote your time to digging further into these plugins.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to go to two podcasts so we get even more information from you and this kind of thing. So remind folks of your Kickstarter plugin again, your Kickstarter campaign again.
Well, the Kickstarter can be found at WPPluginsA2Z.com or A2Z.com for all my American friends. Being Canadian, I forget that a chunk of the world doesn't use Z. WPPluginsA2Z.com Kickstarter, and you can go view the Kickstarter up there. The Kickstarter is, again, to help turn the WPPluginsA2Z podcast into a full-time business for me instead of the part-time gig that it has been for the last 4 or 5 years that I've been doing it, and allow me to add in a second show, which will be interviews with the developers, allow me to refine the website, turn it into a membership website, offering up premium content such as training and other information, add in a forums, maybe a forum that will actually work in the WordPress community. I mean, I've run into a few that have started and they run into so many problems, they end up abandoning them. These are the sorts of things I've got planned. If you want to see all the plans for it, go to WPPluginsA2Z.com/Kickstarter and check it out. It's fully explained there.
And the reason that I donated immediately, I mean, I got an email from John. I'm doing this. You know, I appreciate your support. I jumped on it immediately. I asked him to come on Blab immediately because of it, because he's been serving our community as a professional volunteer for a long time. I appreciate everything that you do, John.
I appreciate you introducing me to Blab here because I didn't even know it existed. And since you've introduced me to it, it's been a week now. I've had two shows and been on several shows and been meeting lots of really great people. This is quite the interesting platform. So
it is. I love it. But I definitely want to show my gratitude to you. And I hope everybody else does too, for all the people who, you know, the community is so full of selfless people. But this is so far above and beyond what John is doing and providing. All that testing takes a lot of time. I know. I do it. And so, it, you know, being able to give back to somebody who's giving so much to us is such a wonderful thing to do. And for your plugin developers, all these free plugins, you know, a $5 donation makes a world of difference to them. Yeah. And just, it's not a ton of money, but it helps their enthusiasm and their motivation to do these things. Well, if you're making money from your site, here's the whole thing. If you're making money off the backs of these other people's work, I want you to think about that a minute.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I used to, before I started buying premium plugins, I used to regularly kick money to the developers for all the free plugins I was using because I wanted to keep them encouraged to keep updating the plugin. I didn't want them to abandon it once they got out of college. I want them to find a way to turn it into a business.
Absolutely.
But that's one of the big things. If you're using a free plugin, kick that author $5.
$5, guys, it makes a lot of difference. You don't think it does, but it matters. Okay, let's talk about, again, searching for plugins. Let's go back to that for just a second, because I do reviews of plugins, but, you know, I'm going into that testing phase and that kind of thing, looking at performance. You know, mine are pretty deep. Yeah. There are a lot of folks who regularly talk about plugins, and all they're looking at is fashion. They never even load it. They never even test it. They're just regurgitating what they've seen on, you know, 15 or 20 other websites about it. How can people vet what they're looking at and trust? I mean, it's kind of hard to.
It's very hard to vet it. If it hasn't been tested by the person reviewing it, how do they know what it's functionality actually is? I mean, I could go through and I could create a show a minute by just reading out the descriptions from the developers, because they're always glowing. They're always fantastic. You know, the plugin's the most gorgeous thing on the planet. It helps cure cancer and everything else. But the truth shows when you install it on a website, and we're not talking just installing on a brand new install of WordPress. We're talking install it on a website where you have dozens of other plugins running, because that's the environment that users are going to put it in. And one of the things, my test site has probably the 20 most common plugins that everyone uses for forms, e-commerce store, all of the most common plugins. So when I test a plugin, it's being tested with those plugins to make sure it works. Oftentimes, there'll be times where I'll even put it up on my personal site, because my personal site is a major site I have to keep live. So if I break something there, I'll really know.
Well, and it's being loaded in a whole other way too, being live, and that'll bring up its own little demons. I don't want to harp on Yoast Evolve at all. I'm a fan of his. I'm a fan of his plugins. So I don't want to turn this into a rant session for anybody else to do this. But when he had, you know, the 3.0 version come out, I'm just saying that because it was recent, and it broke some things. It didn't work well with WordFence and a few others, and there were a lot of bugs in it. And, you know, people, this was the free version, and the complaints, the level of language and hate and whatever that was piled on him for that was atrocious. I mean, it was absolutely disgusting. Yeah. People were saying, you know, somebody needs to be burned at the stake and whatever. You wouldn't say that. I don't know if you'd say that to somebody if you were face to face with them, for one thing.
No.
But having zero gratitude for anything, you know, something that's been serving you for years and helping you make money, and the thing breaks, and this is all you've got to say to them is hateful stuff. You know, I think developers, well, if developers can't do it because it's that the customer's always right, or we need to be kind to pay or whatever, I'm not that way. You know, and maybe people like me and others too can jump in there and not defend the fact that it's broken, but put a halt to that kind of hateful language and that level of sense of entitlement from people who've been using free stuff.
Yes.
You know, I think we really need to do a good job of changing our mindsets about free and the people who are providing it. And again, I hope you will consider contributing to John's Kickstarter campaign. To make a pledge for that very thing and that mindset and talk about this with your peeps. John, let's take a very quick, and we're not going to get too deep into this either, because it's still so techy. You know, when there's more to tell end users, we'll get in more into it. But a peek into what's coming, Calypso, PHP 7, plugins, I don't want to go into the technical parts of those, but we're looking at another probably major shift here too in plugin development, aren't we?
We are looking at a major shift in development. I mean, PHP 7, Calypso, I'm just beginning to dig into because they are bleeding edge. And while I do some things bleeding edge, I hadn't touched those as bleeding edge yet. But from the research I'm seeing so far, the changes that are being made is going to require the plugin authors to start making some changes and also updates to it. And the plugins themselves are going to go through changes and how they're going to be developed and how the functionality is going to be delivered. And one of the things that's happening bit by bit, I mean, Jetpack is probably the best example of stuff being delivered for a plugin from a service offsite where the plugin is just the interface. Mm-hmm. And there's going to be more and more of that. That's the service as a software component, the SaaS. And that's going to be more and more as time moves along and as the internet gets a little bit more stable. Because look back 3 years ago, could we have done something like this blab on the internet as easily and smoothly and cleanly as it is now?
Right.
You know, it's the stability is finally there for everything, the cloud service and other areas. Plugin authors are going to move their core services to a subscription basis. And they'll be charging people monthly, yearly, bi-month, whatever subscription model they want to do. And it won't be just the subscription service we have now. The subscription, when you buy a plugin now, it's an open source plugin. Once you buy it, you can do whatever you want with it. But if you want updates, you pay them a service to access those updates. You also pay them. Yeah, you pay them for access to their forums. That's one of the big things. People think they're buying a plugin. They're not buying that plugin. What they're buying when they buy that premium service, they're buying access to the support and they're buying access to the regular updates provided by the author that are going to plug the security holes that are going to appear because the security holes are there.
Right. And that's what I was going to say. You know, it used to be a time when that first started, I think a few years ago, that people would buy it once, but never renew because I don't need to update somewhere. But security has changed so much. Hosts have lowered ceilings on resource usage.
Yes,
and so you can get into a problem with that if you don't keep that puppy updated. Plus, WordPress is just changing so often. They're offloading, they're putting so much more into the core of WordPress that the plugin doesn't have to carry that bulk anymore. Yep. And so it improves your performance radically. And so now it is truly worthwhile to keep up. Well, you have to.
You have to.
You need those updates, right?
You have to. You have to get those updates, whether you do them quarterly at the very minimal, or you do them when the author, like I have a couple of plugins that I use from Envato. It's like every 3 weeks I get an update from that author for the plugin. You know, sometimes more. It depends. Sometimes they discover a whole series of security flaws, and all of a sudden it's boom, 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 boom. A new plugin gets delivered.
Well, we have a whole community of white hat hackers that are doing that, and they've got a lot of peer pressure in their forums and whatever to not disclose any problems that they find until they contact the developer first and give them a chance to fix it. And then they publicly let everybody know about it. So by the time you hear about it, it's usually already fixed. The update's already been issued, and you're already ahead of the game, right?
You're ahead of the game, provided you've done the update, because what happens once it becomes public, the hackers know about it, and once they know about it, they're busy writing scripts to take advantage of it. And they'll do it within days to weeks after a security flaw is noticed. There's scripts wandering through the web looking for the vulnerable WordPress websites.
Right.
And they find them,
that's
toast.
Why it's so important for you to keep up with people like John. If you haven't followed him yet, please do that right now. And be sure that you subscribe to his podcast, which we're hoping is going to go to 2 times a week here too, and maybe a forum for that. You know, I'll be in there, John, for that to keep up with what things are going. So, guys, you know, we're about halfway through our show here. I want to open it up and unlock the seat, let folks come in. And, John, is there anything else you want us to know about while people are the seat is open. Y'all come on in, ask your questions, pop them over into the comments. Pop us up some comments if you're enjoying, you know, the show here with John, and let us know what's going on, and ask your questions. And we will definitely, if you got a question about a specific plugin, I bet you John has tested it. He may not have that test result right off the top of his head.
But well, it might be there somewhere in that big brain.
Yeah. Well, and while y'all are waiting to come in, and please feel free. That's the whole fun of Blab. Come on, guys. We don't care about your hair, your clothes, whatever's going on. Come on. Come as you are. John, I want to ask you about a few plugins in particular types, not specific ones. And I think we mentioned this in another Blab, but I want to catch it here for sure. Things like recipe plugins. Now, I have a lot of craft and lifestyle blogger peeps, you know, they come to me to get site audits and whatever. Recipes are a big thing for them. And I haven't found, I mean, every one of the recipe plugins in some way or another is going to put a performance hit on it.
Yeah.
You got to take that hit because it's part of your draw. So it really behooves you to find the very best plugin that you can that has the best look and the least hit to do that with, right? Because it could cost you money and time and perform, you know, time of loading the site and abandonment of that and that kind of thing too, right?
Yes, it can. Plus, the other thing is what's going to happen if you decide to change that recipe plugin to all the information you've entered in there. So I've run into that problem where I started with one recipe plugin. The client got through about 30 or 40 recipes, and we found there was too many problems with it. We had to change it out. And so we had to actually re-enter the recipes. So the one I use now allows it a little bit easier transition if you decide to leave that plugin.
Right. Well, tell people what it is, because I know they're curious.
It's called Recipe Plus.
Okay.
It's a really nice plugin.
For that, because I know a lot of craft people are here listening to this today. So Easy Recipes Plus for that.
Yeah.
I've got the same issue with things that embed, like click to tweet sort of things.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get rid of whatever service you're using or plugin or whatever it is. And guys, it's not just plugins, it's service like Smushit. You know, the click to tweet, you know, Twitter just took out share accounts. And so all plugins that had share accounts for Twitter have been affected. And some of them have services that you can buy into that will guesstimate that kind of thing. So you have to be really careful what you get locked into these days too, especially if it's embedding. If you lose Twitter account, maybe that's not as horrible as having to redo all of your recipes, right?
No, it wouldn't be so horrible to lose your Twitter settings, you know, because the content will still be there.
Right.
But, recipes, rebuilding them takes time. But recipe plugins, great thing to have. I find the new project I launched probably 4 months ago, one of our biggest draws to it now being a fitness website is the recipes. And we really weren't quite expecting that to be the bigger draw, but it is.
Absolutely. Guys, y'all got any questions for John, or did we cover it? Come on, I know you got a question or two for him.
This is my first
while he's here.
Kickstarter, Barb.
Barb's asking, is this your first Kickstarter campaign?
This is my first Kickstarter campaign and probably will be my only one.
Hi, Barb. Good, always good to see you here.
Well, Barb, I just saw you on another show.
Yeah, I don't think I've seen you live. So happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you, man. Can you hear me okay?
Oh, yeah, yes. Perfectly.
I'm, you look great, I Barb, have don't to worry. Apologize for my appearance today. I'm very techie today. So.
Yeah, you're fantastic.
Trying to get stuff done.
I love your flag.
Yeah.
You sure?
Brittany sent that to me. So,
love it.
So here's the thing, John. I can help you with your Kickstarter. I don't know if you know, yeah. I have a history on Kickstarter. You can look me up on there. You follow me on Twitter, and you'll see that I'm following a campaign right now that's going to be finishing up in the next 24 hours. I don't want to get off topic, but just follow me, find that, and I'm Barb T USA on there. You need help. Okay,
okay.
On that. So back to the plugin.
That.
So maybe we can trade because I have over 100 Ooh. Domains running on WordPress, but I also bought into a PLR WordPress program, plugin program. Mm-hmm. My corporation did some time ago. And I've kept the PLR membership because I like the programmer who actually started it. And I thought, well, eventually I'll monetize this. And because I needed to use the plugins, my purpose for buying it was because I had 100 sites anyway. I could use the plugins, you know, on the sites that I had. Didn't really matter. So licensing wise, I was covered. But now what I've been reading, you know, and been encouraged to do to monetize that was to go over to Fiverr and get other programmers to actually do customization to mm-hmm. that. And immediately my fear was security.
Yes.
because I have 100 domains. I don't need somebody from the Philippines that I don't know coming in
right.
and messing things up. Mm-hmm. And I just wondered if you had experience in using those PLR plugins or other programmers from JVZoo who are doing those kinds of things.
No, I have this little problem of not wanting to send my work anywhere offshore. I hire local developers here in my town to do my work. I pay a premium for them, but I can go talk to them. I can meet them for lunch if I have a problem. I can sit down with them. To me, offshoring might save me initially money, but too many times I've heard from the people that have offshored to have something done, such as a customization for a plugin, that customization suddenly became a problem, a headache. The developer offshore, their website was compromised, it was hacked, or if that doesn't happen to you, which is a rare case, granted, you might have problems getting to them. If something doesn't work or it needs updated again, sometimes you go to contact that developer and they've moved on to something else and they no longer even work in that environment anymore. I've had that happen with a client where they offshored some customization, a custom plugin. When they went back to the developer, that developer no longer even worked in PHP. He was onto a whole new different coding language and he didn't want to go backwards. So they had to actually bring it to me and I took it to my coder who took care of the problem. That's why I don't go offshore. I start local. Before I go anywhere else, I try to start with my local community. If I can't find my support here, then I move further and further out as it goes.
Mm-hmm. John, I want to jump in a second and make a comment there, what you said about moving to a different language with things going JavaScript. That's a big deal right now because whatever you have coded, if you know the rest, if they're not up on the latest technology and exactly what's happening with WordPress right now and everything moving toward JavaScript and they're not up on JavaScript, which a lot of programmers aren't, they specialize in PHP, then you're going to have a problem down the road. You could spend $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 or way more getting something that's going to be obsolete in a year.
That could happen too.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to find out if they are up to date with the latest standards for WordPress.
Right.
But,
well, I've one of the beautiful things about Blab is that aside from meeting face to face physically, I use Facebook Messenger within Facebook to communicate with folks from other countries. But then I have been dealing with folks who live in around the world, you know, since the 80s. But that comfort zone of what is going on now, security wise, just like what you're saying, it's like, I don't even trust the guy who lives in the same town.
Yeah, that can happen too.
But it's just, you know, really no more. I mean, I can actually, I can code myself, but it's all about time and place.
That's so, pretty much it. It's all about time.
Yeah, pretty much.
Everything requires time. We should,
right, and our priorities. But thank you very much. I appreciate you sharing your insight.
If you need a
referral, happy New Year, everybody.
The young coder I have doing work for me, brilliant kid, half my age, but he's so intelligent, it's scary.
That's when they do their best work.
Yeah.
Well, they don't have anything else in life but coding.
That's
partying.
What I'm talking about.
That's
them and
life.
Mathematicians. They all do it before they're 30. You know, they hit the brilliance before they're 30, or definitely by the time they're 40, they're done. So they've moved on to do something else. Barb, thank you so much.
I don't know that coders ever die.
No, they don't. They don't. But they become project managers and get these kids in. So always appreciate you helping John with his Kickstarter campaign too. John, she is a fabulous person to know.
Yeah, and I will be connecting with her. I've got her page on Twitter opened up, so I'll get back to it after the show.
Absolutely. Definitely do that. Anybody else got questions for John? We're coming toward the end of the show here. And if you got questions, now would be that time to ask. John, do you have any kind of way to search for plugins on your site? You know, you've got your Dragon ratings and that kind of thing. But how's the best way to go searching on your site?
I have a search bar there. It uses not the WordPress core, but a plugin that modifies it, so it comes up a little bit better. Just type in the name of a plugin or the functionality you want. I'm learning how to do my notes, and I'll probably, the Kickstarter succeeds, I'll be going through back notes to fix what I should have done in the back shows as far as adding keywords or specific references for the plugins. Because a lot of times, doing it part-time, what happened, I share my notes with my co-host, and we write a page of notes, and what happened, those notes got cut and pasted into the website because we got the show recorded and everything, and I realized, I got to get the show up. Cut, paste, notes, it's up. You know, no editing because I had to move on to a project. So there's lots of things I need to fix, but again, it's all about time. And you have to make a living, and that's where my development business helped me make a living. So.
Absolutely. And guys, please do support John's Kickstarter campaign. And here I am supporting. My money is where my mouth is.
Yeah, absolutely.
I have so much gratitude for all the work that you do, John. Thank you so much for everything that you've done for this community with plugins, all the heavy testing. It's the good stuff, guys. And be sure to follow his podcast as well so you can keep up with these things too. And I'm going to put a link in here right quick to the show notes where on my site, where you can find the replay of this. You can also find show notes and find these links that we've been talking about to get to John and find him online as well. John, thank you so very much for being here today.
Oh, happy to have been here.
Absolutely. And please do put a link again in there so it'll be right at the bottom of the comments because that shows in the replay too, to your site so folks can find you again. And that's to the podcast.
There's the podcast link.
That's great. That's great. All right, y'all. Have a good day. Oh, and I'm gonna close the show out here, but stick around a second because I got news for everybody that stays to the end. So thanks for joining the WordPress Blab here. We're here every Wednesday, and please do follow and subscribe to the Blog A Blab channel, and I'll see you online.